So let's start today's tutorial on this is our last tutorial on assignment 2, and I will talk about MongoDB and remote debugging. This is very useful for both your assignment 2 and also your project development. So we will go into MongoDB first. Okay, so I first give you some introduction on MongoDB and also the corresponding Node.js library for operating on MongoDB. So MongoDB is a document-oriented database. What this means is that all the records are in documents format, and the documents are in JSON format. So MongoDB is basically a collection of JSON documents. And we usually classify this as non-SQL database because we want to differentiate with the traditional database architecture, which is a relational database, like MySQL or PGSQL or Oracle SQL. They are all SQL database. But we are going into a new category of database, which is NoSQL. So MongoDB saw all its data in JSON-like documents. And you can use dynamic schema. And the reason that MongoDB is often used with Node.js is that because the format, MongoDB stores the records in JSON format, and Node.js can pass these kind of documents very easily. So many Node.js applications use MongoDB. And Heroku provides MongoDB add-ons, and the name is MLab MongoDB. And to install a MongoDB for your Heroku app, it is very simple. You just click a few buttons and then you get a working MongoDB with a very easy friendly UI. So it is very useful for using MongoDB on Heroku. And Mongoose. Mongo is an object data modeling library for MongoDB, and it is a Node module. You can use npm install to include this library in your applications. And it has many supported features like built-in typecasting and validation, query building, and business logic hooks. These features are for your convenience or for development. So many times you need to do data validation for your database, and you don't want to write it yourself. And this library provides these features for you. You don't need to write it yourself. So let's see how to use the Mongoose library. First, you need to install it. You use npm install Mongoose, the name of the library, and you include the save arguments to specify to ask the npm tool to update your package.json file. And then you need to enable MongoDB service in Heroku. And I will do the demo here. Now I create a new app. And let's take this name. And then you can include the MongoDB add-on. You go to the add-on tab here and then find more add-ons. Then you scroll down and find here, MLab MongoDB. So there's a button for installing on MongoDB. You click on it and then select which application you want to install to. And this is my application, submit. And then it will go back to the dashboard. Then you need to select the plan you want to use. There are many different plans, but I only use the free one. It should be enough for both your assignment and project. So you get a MongoDB now. And it provides a very useful, user-friendly UI. You can see the documents inside the database. So this is the UI. It's like PHP MyAdmin for MySQL. So for MongoDB, it has something like that. And now we want to connect to the MongoDB. So you need to find how can we connect to the database. You need to get the URI. MongoDB URI. So you can go to the settings tab here and then config variables. Let me go back and then review config variables. And this is your URI for connecting to MongoDB. Now I copy it. Copy. And then go to the code. So this is the code for connecting to the database. There are different paths. First, you need to load the module into your program. So I use require Mongoose to load the module. And then you can use this variable to access the connection. And I will put the URI string, that is the URI for connecting to the database, in this variable. And later, I will put it in a module so you don't need to hard code the URI in each script. So I put the URI here, and then I put the URI at this position. And this part is for when you deploy your app on Heroku, then Heroku will set the environment variable, and you can access its value here. So you don't need to hard code the URI in your program. You can just access this variable. And I put the URI after this one because I want to do local development. I don't want to, every time I want to test my program, then I deploy to Heroku. This is very troublesome. So I add this part, the highlighted part, and to specify that when the MongoLab URI variable is not available, then I use the hard code URI after this. So I don't need to hard code the URI. When the application is on Heroku, then I use this value. If it is on my local machine, then I use this value. So this is a good practice. And then I need to set up some event handlers. Basically, there are two main handlers you want to use. The first one is error. When the connection has some problem, then you need to handle the error. And my way to handle it is just to print it out. And if the connection is okay, then the open event is triggered. And then you can do your stuff inside the event handler. So this is my event handler. Basically, I just print something to the console and then close the connection. After I set up the event handlers, I can connect to the MongoDB. So I call mongoose.connect and then my URI string. And that's it. So I can go to my code and then update the URI string. And let's see what will happen. Connect. So I execute node and then connect.js, and you can see that the connection is established and then it disconnects. If my string is not correct, let's say I remove something, then you will see an error. It keeps retrying, but you can see nothing here until it is timeout. I don't want to wait for it to time out, so I control C it. Okay. And then I want to save something to my database. So when you use Mongoose, then it helps you to map documents to objects. And before it can do the mapping, you need to define the schema of the object. The schema basically means the structure of the object. So you define the schema by using mongoose.schema and then put all the fields you want to use. Let's say I have a user schema, which is for defining a user. And I want to have these fields. I want to have a name, which is of the string type, and then an age, which is a number, active, boolean, and then rows. Since a user may have multiple rows, so I use an array here. To specify an array, you just put the schema inside the square bracket. So it becomes an array. You can have multiple rows now. But inside the array, it should be another row, another schema. So I define a row schema here. the row schema has two fields. It's two fields.
The first
field is type, which is a number, and then a description, a string. So by using this function, the mongo.schema, you can define multiple schemas. And the supported types for the fields are listed here. You can use string or number, days, buffer, boolean mix, object ID, or an array, which is the object supported in Node.js. So you just put the type here, you can use it. And after you define the schema, you cannot use it directly. You need to create a model for the schema first. So the model is to for using the schema. Because it needs to set up some functions for the model. So you need to convert the schema into a model. So when you access the database, you always use the model. The schema is just the definition of the structure. So you need to convert it into a model. So you use mongoose.model and then pass the model name and then the schema name, and you can get a model. And because the model will be used very frequently in your code, so I usually put it in a node module. So let's see how do I do it. So this is my code for creating a new object in the database. So I load two modules here. These two modules is developed by me. So I load the module. First, I put the model in model.js. Inside this file, I first define the schema. And then I create a model based on the schema. And then, because I always need to use this variable, the user model, so I put it as the thing I expose to this module. I use module.expose and then equal to user. Then when you load this module in another script, let's say in create.js, when you call require and then model, then this variable will be equal to the user model, which is this thing. So I don't need to put the schema in all of my code. I just put it in one of the module file, and then I load the module when I need to use the model. Okay. And the URI string. The URI string is for connecting to the database, and it may be updated when you change from development environment to production environment. So I don't put it in each of the file. I put it in a node module. So this module is very simple. I just put the string as the value of module.expose. I use this one, and I also need to update these values. I use the URI string provided by Heroku. Okay, that's it. And let's see how to do different operations in MongoDB. So there are four major operations for a database. Create, CRUD, the first one is create, and then read, U is update, and B is delete. So let's see how to do these four operations. So this is create.js. I am going to create a new user called Alice. So I use the module. This one mesh with this one. The user model. I use the user model. I call new on the user model, and then I put the values of the fields of this object. So I set up the name as Alice, and the age is 18. Active is true, and then I set up a role for her. The role is has two types, two fields. The first field is type, and I set it to one, a number, and then a description, and then I could. By doing this, I create a new user. But it is not saved to the database yet, because you don't specify, you don't ask the Mongoose to save it to the database. So I need to call on this object, I call save. then it will save this object into the database. Let us stop save, and then you pass a callback function. When there's error, then you print it out. If there's no error, then you disconnect the database. So let's see. Nope, and then create. Now I created a new object, and you can check it in the MLab UI. This is my MLab UI. I refresh. And then you can see under collections, you can find a new collections called users, and there's one document. So basically, documents means an object when you use the Mongoose library. It maps a document to an object. So this is my object. Okay. So this is the content of the new object. I create a new user called Alice. So you can find its name here. And there are some other things. You can see some underscore ID or underscore V. You don't need to care about that. This is for Mongoose to work. So you don't need to care about it. And you can see that this object is in JSON format. Basically, in MongoDB, all the records are in JSON format. So now we just create a new record in the database. And the next operation is R, is to read a record from the database. So again, inside the event handler of open, this one, you can use the user model to find all users. So the way to do it is to use the user model and then call dot find. Then you pass a callback function. And this callback function takes two parameters. The first one is error, and the second one is users. Users is the objects inside this code, for this user model. So this is users. This is an array. And inside the callback function, I print all the users out. So let's see. Nope, and then read.js. So you can see I just print the records in the database. This is an object, and the name is Alice. So what if I don't want to load all the users? I just want to find the users with name Alice. So I can use this code, user.find, and then the first parameter now is equal to an object, and inside this object, the name is Alice. So this means that when I read a record from a database, I need to fulfill this requirement. I need to have a record whose name is Alice. And then again, I pass a callback function, and let's see, the result is the same, but if I change this to another name which does not exist in the database, then it should return an empty array. So this object is for specifying the searching criteria. Okay, and then the next operation is update. So it is also very simple. Now I use find by ID to find one user from the database. So the user ID is just this one, underscore ID, which is generated by MongoDB. So I use this to find a user, and then I update its value. I want to update its age. So you use user.findById and then pass the user ID here, and then a callback function. The second parameter is a user. Now I update the value of the user. I set its age to 22. And then I save it to the database. So when I run the code and then pass the user ID here, then it tells me that it is updated. Now let's see. should change. Now I want to find all users, so I use this code and then disable this one. Okay, I'm freeing all the records in the database, and now Alice age becomes 22. So I updated its value. So you can see that updating a record in the database is very simple. You just update a view of the object and then you save it to the database. The last operation is delete. To delete a record, this is very similar. You first find the user from the database, you use user.findById, and then you get the user object. And on this user object, you call remove. Then this record will be removed from the database. Oh, and I run this code and then pass the user ID. Then the object will be removed. If I go back to the MongoDB UI and refresh, then this will become an empty collection. You can see nothing here, no documents, because I just removed all the entries inside this collection. So we just covered four operations on MongoDB, and there are many more operations you can do on the MongoDB. So you need to read the documentation to see what operations you can use. And I just demonstrate how to use the MongoLab UI. This is very simple. You can even add documents or delete documents from the UI. So that's the end of this part, the Mongoose part. And the next topic is remote debugging on Android or iOS devices. So because your assignment tool or even your project may need to do web developments on mobile devices, so I want to talk about this topic. For desktop, you can do debugging very easily. You can just use the developer tools for debugging. But for mobile devices, you cannot access the development tool on your phone. So you need to do remote debugging. The way to do it is very simple. The most complicated part is setting up the device, and I will go through the steps for you. So for Android users, you need to use Chrome or Firefox. I don't know if other browsers also support remote debugging, but the mainstream browser, Chrome and Firefox, support it. And you need to have a USB cable. You cannot do it remotely. You need to have a cable. And you need to install Chrome on both your Android device and on your computer. And for iOS users, you can use Safari. You can only use Safari. On iOS, you cannot do remote debugging on Chrome because of the limitation set up by Apple. So you can only use Safari for debugging. So now let's see the steps of setting up your Android device. The first step is to enable USB debugging. So you go to the settings and then find developer options. If you cannot find this option, that means that this option is hidden. So you need to enable it first. To enable it, you go to About Tablet or About Phone, this one. Go to this page and then scroll down and find build number, and then click on it for 7 times. And the developer options will be enabled for you. This is because Google want to protect the device from being modified by common users. So they hide the developer options by default. So you enable it, and then go to developer options, and then check this box, USB debugging, and click OK. The next step is to connect your device to your development machine. And if you are using Windows, you need to install the corresponding USB drivers. And after this, you can open the Chrome on your desktop and then enter this URI, Chrome, and then inspect, and then track this box, discover USB devices. And if your setting is okay, you should see your device here. In my screenshot, I use a Nexus 7, so I can see it here. But you cannot do debugging yet, because you have to give permission to the debugging process. So you go back to the Android device and then check, and then click OK to allow USB debugging. Then you will see the tab open in your Android device. So I can see my page here. When I open the Chrome and then go to this page, then the page will be displayed on your desktop. And then you can click Inspect to open the development tools. And the usage of the development tool is the same as that of the one for desktop. So you will see this console. You can do anything on it. You can go to the console page to see some JavaScript errors, or go to the network tab to see what file is downloaded, or go to elements tab to see the DOM sheet. So the usage is basically the same as that for desktop. And there are some tips you can do with, you can refresh the page on your Android device by clicking F5 or Command Alt for Mac on desktop. So you don't need to go back to the phone and then click refresh. You just go to the development console and then enter this shortcut and it will be reloaded. And you can even check the network waterfall to debug for the network traffic. And you can even go to the timeline panel to see the rendering or CPU usage. And if you like Firefox, Firefox also provides remote debugging feature. And the setting is basically the same. You need to enable USB debugging and also set up some configuration on the Firefox on your Android device, and then go to the browser to install something, and then open the console like this. So I will skip it. And if you are using iOS, you can only use Safari for debugging. So I will demonstrate the setting here. So this is my iOS device here. I need to go to settings and then find Safari, and then scroll down, find advanced, and you need to enable this option, web inspector, this one. After enabling it, you can open Safari on your desktop and then set up its preferences on the advanced tab. Check this box. Show develop menu in menu bar, and you will find this new menu item here. And now I go back to my phone. And then I go to the page I want to do debugging. This is my page I want to do debugging. I go to this page on Safari, and then you, on the desktop Safari, you click develop, and then choose your device, and find the page you want to debug. This one. Then you can see the console here. You can see the DOM sheet on the element tag, and when you select on it, when you select on it, on your phone, the corresponding DOM object will be highlighted. You can even do some modification. Let's say I want to remove this div, I delete it. Then the page become empty because I remove all the contents. You can even go to the console. Go to the console and type something. Let's say I want to have an alert boss. Then on your phone, you can see an alert boss here. So everything you do on the console will take effect on the mobile Safari. If I refresh, click the refresh button. Oh, I need to close this first. Refresh. Then this page will be reloaded. So you can use the console for debugging or see whether there is any JavaScript error. So here are the steps. So that's all for remote debugging. For Safari, you can for Mac, for iOS, you can only use Safari for debugging. And the last part of today's tutorial is to debugging WebSocket in Chrome or Firefox. So I go back to Chrome, and then go to a page with WebSocket. I use the Socket IO chat room for demonstrating how to do debugging on Chrome. So I go to the development console and go to network tag, reload. By default, you will see all the resources downloaded when you load this page. But if you only want to see if there are any WebSocket connections, you go to WebSocket tag, WS. If you can see something here, then you are doing in the right direction. Click on it. You will see headers here, and if you want to see the data transferred through this WebSocket connection, you can go to the frames tab, and you can see the control message by Socket IO. These are control message by Socket IO. If you send a message, then you will see the sent message being displayed here. So if you can see all these things in this tape, then you are doing right. So this is debug in Chrome. If you use Firefox, you can refer to the instructions here. This is very similar. You also go to development tool and then find WebSocket. You filter all the WebSocket connection, and then you can do debugging. And so that's it. And I also upload a final checklist for assignment 2. If you have already finished assignment 2, then you can go to this page and check if you miss anything. I basically put all the important things in point form so you can check more easily. So after you submit your assignment 2, you better go to this page to check if you have already fulfilled all the requirements. So that's all for the tutorials on assignment 2, and next week we will start a new topic, which is optional. And I will talk about Backbone.js. This is our MVC framework for front-end development, so you can integrate it with React.js, so you have Backbone.js for handling the model parts, the data exchange between the server and clients, and you can also rely on React.js to render the view for you. So you can have an MVC architecture on front end, and this is a good way to structure your code because it will be more easy. It will be easier to manage your application. So I will talk about how to use Backbone.js to build a to-do list. And I will talk about what is RESTful APIs. So that's all for today's tutorial.